Wow, what a way to start a service. Good morning, everyone, here in the congregation, here in the sanctuary, and welcome to you out there in YouTube land. Everybody give them a hand. Glad to have you here. Glad we have freedom. We have freedom because 79 years ago tomorrow, this country was viciously attacked by another country who wanted to oppress us with tyranny. But the good news is, it was appropriate you picked that song because there was a lot of smoke on the water in Hawaii that day. But the good news is 2,000 years before that, somebody came into this world that would permanently overcome oppression and tyranny. And that's what we're getting ready to celebrate. That's what's important about this December month, and that is the birth of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We know that in the end, tyranny and oppression will not win, because how many have read the book of Revelation and know that Jesus Christ wins? And if He's living in you today, He's the shining light in you. His light surrounds you because that's who He was. He came into this world to spread light in the darkness. So those of us that are saved, praise Jesus, we have the light in us. I know I don't act that way sometimes, but we still have it nonetheless. The Bible says we should let our light shine before men so that they can see the glory of God and praise Jesus, right? So let's stand on our feet if we can and are able. If you're not, that's fine. Let's get our hearts ready to worship the Lord. Let's pray. Father God, thank You for freedom. Thank You for the men and women who shed their blood so many years ago so that we could still stand here today. We know that You're in control no matter what's going on politically around us, and whatever's going to happen is in Your control. Father, I pray this morning that You would bless Pastor Todd as he brings the message that he's prepared, that You've given to him. That all hearts will receive it, all ears will hear it loudly, and that we will apply it to our lives even this very day. And Your will would be done. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You give.
Give the Lord a hand, everybody.
Thank you.
Okay, and good morning and welcome to church again. Give the Lord a hand, everybody. He is worthy to be praised. Amen. So, who read their chapter this week? Let's get that out of the way right away. Raise your hand if you just read your Bibles at all this week. Raise your hand. Okay. I got to have a talk with some of you people in private.
But
you couldn't raise your hand. So you, if you can't raise your hand, you know, quite honestly, you should feel bad. And I know I'm supposed to patty cake people and make them feel good, but if you didn't read your Bibles last week, feel bad about it. Go ahead. And that way, maybe you won't feel, you'll motivate you to not feel bad next week. Don't cheat yourself. And this week, we are in John chapter 11, which I made that announcement last week, and I'm going to make the next week's announcement now, because I still get people calling me, and that's fine. If you don't remember what it is, please call or text me, and I'd like to tell you, because I'd like you to come prepared. Next week is Ephesians chapter 2, and Pastor Mark will be preaching. So read that chapter next week. We are continuing in this series that I'm calling Portraits of Jesus as we lead up to Christmas. Full speed. Does it seem like Christmas is sneaking up on you? Full speed, right? We have 3 Sundays to go. How about that? It's coming fast. Some people are excited. Some people aren't ready. It's my hope and prayer that we can slow down some. Just slow down a little bit. You know what I mean? Because it seems like if you just think of the whole thing as a whole, of what you got to do, what presents you got to buy, who's coming over, what food you're cooking, or what, you got to get your house cleaned, or you got to wrap presents, and you got, I mean, there's a lot of stuff to do, and it seems like, oh man, I can't do anything, but just, I got to work at this. Just stop. Just slow down. It's going to be okay. Read your Bible. Think about what Christmas is about. About the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? You think he's coming to inspect your house to see if there's any dust? You know what I'm saying? So keep things into perspective. That's what I hope that we can do together. And each day, hopefully you read your Bible and just reflect a little bit on the gift that was given to mankind. You know, especially to you, but then to everyone. That God loved all people so much that he did what he did when he gave the gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, title of the sermon still is just Portraits of Jesus. And it's going to be in John chapter 11 today. And here we have the miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead. Here in John chapter 11. And surprisingly enough, a lot of people don't realize it was the third time Jesus raised someone from the dead. Documented in Mark chapter 5 is Jairus' daughter. You can read about that. And then we have the son of the widow of Nain in Luke chapter 7. You can read about that. But I think here in John chapter 11, there's a portrait of Jesus that I wanted to focus in on. Because I think oftentimes the picture of Jesus that we get from this encounter here in John chapter 11 is somewhat out of focus. So maybe we can take the focus knob a little bit with our mind of understanding and the help of the Holy Spirit and God teaching us today, and we can focus in on a picture of Jesus and draw closer to him. So if you don't mind, bow your heads with me and let us pray and prepare our hearts for what the Lord has to tell us today. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for a time and place that we are able to come together as your people, gather and care for one another and have fellowship with one another, and then worship you and praise you and then learn from your word, Father. We just thank you for that. Give us that heart of thanksgiving where we are able to receive from you this morning. I ask now that you just remove all the hindrances and distractions in this place and in me, in us, Father. Remove our self-distractions that we have. Help us to focus on you. Anoint my lips to preach your word today. Give us all ears to receive it with, a heart to receive it with, and help us just to feel your presence with the Holy Spirit here and now. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So we are going to be in John chapter 11. I'm going to start reading in verse 14 if you want to kind of mark that spot. I'll give you just a quick lead up so I don't have to read all the previous 14 verses. Jesus and his disciples had fled across the Jordan River to steer clear of the Jews from chapter 10, if you'd read that, who wanted to stone Jesus for blasphemy. And they were getting real serious about it. And they were all fearful that they... I mean, Jesus wasn't fearful. Come on. You know what I'm saying? He knew he wasn't going to get stoned or die before he went to the cross. He knew what was coming. The disciples were certainly fearful that they were going to kill them all. And they had fled across the river. This blasphemy I talked about was he called himself the Son of God, and they didn't like it. They didn't like the truth. And all those who don't come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ are in the same place. They don't like the truth. That's the way it is. So the sisters here, Martha and Mary, it says that Jesus loved them. He loved their brother Lazarus. They sent a message to Jesus because he was away, telling him that Lazarus was sick and to come, because they believed he could heal him, because he'd done many healings. And they said, come now, you know, our brother's sick and probably going to die. So the purpose of this miracle is revealed to us by Jesus himself in verse 15. That's why I'm going to start in 14. I'm just going to read 14 to get a little something through to us. So let's start right there. Verse 14, then Jesus said unto them, he said unto his disciples that were around him, he said, Lazarus is dead. He's already dead. Okay? And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there to the intent, here's the intention, that ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. So the intention of this miracle is to foster this belief. It's to jumpstart the faith, even in the disciples who, I mean, they're with Jesus. We're talking about John, the guy that wrote this book. He apparently needed a jumpstart. Jesus said, I'm glad we weren't there for your sake. And so Jesus as the Messiah. So let us read on here, verse 16. Then said Thomas, sometimes you're glad that, you know, we call this guy Doubting Thomas. Sometimes you read little sections of the Bible and you're like, man, I'm glad I wasn't the guy that said some things, right? But I don't think Thomas said something too bad here. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, he said unto his fellow disciples, he said to the rest, because Jesus said, let's go. Let's go back into danger. Let's go back across the Jordan. Let's go to where they want to kill us, basically. And Thomas says to the rest of them, he's like, okay, let us go that we may die with him. Lazarus is dead. Now we can all go and die. It can be taken a few ways. Right? Like a text message. You ever get a text message and somebody was trying to be nice to you, but you took it as they were trying to be rude? Things don't come across always in a text, right? So I don't know how bad this was for Thomas to say this. I like to take it this way. I like to take it that he was in fear of his life. He knew going back maybe they would get killed, yet he also knew that his life meant nothing without Jesus. He's like, if Jesus is going to go back, we might as well go with him, because if they kill him, they might as well kill us. Because without him, we got nothing. Are you there, Christian? Without Jesus, you got nothing. Is that where you're at in your walk? That is a reality. You have nothing without the Lord Jesus Christ. Might as well just quit now without him. And so I like to kind of think that's, I mean, where he was at. I mean, seriously, what's your life worth without Jesus? Think about it. Well, I own this truck. I own this house. Maybe you're like Kevin, you got a backhoe. Kevin and Randy own backhoes. You own maybe like Andy, you got semi-trucks and a fleet of trucks maybe. What's it all worth without the Lord Jesus Christ? It's all just going to go away. Just stuff that's going to go away. You last forever in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Verse 17, let's read on. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave for 4 days already. He was good and dead. You know, good and dead. So, 18. Now Bethany, this is where they were at, was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs, not far off. 19. And many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Sounds like a nice verse, a nice thing for these people to do, right? Many of the Jews. And that's what we would think on the surface, but let's get the focus knob out. Let's talk about these Jews a little bit who came to comfort Mary and Martha. So we know, according to Jewish oral tradition, that even poor families must hire at least two flute players and a professional wailing woman to mourn the dead. You had to hire professional people to help you mourn the loss. This was even poor people. And Mary and Martha and their brother, they were pretty well off. If you read and do a little investigating, you pretty much know that's true. And so they had a whole group of people. And it wasn't because they were nice, it was because they were paid. A whole bunch of people came to get a paycheck to comfort them. Okay, so this large group, that's many of the Jews, it says, verse 20. So now that we kind of know what's going on here, we'll read on. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Verse 21, then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not have died. So this is a statement of faith. Once again, I don't think this is a bad thing that she says. She's actually saying that she knew Jesus had the power to heal. Lord, man, I know you wanted to be. I know you loved him. And if you could have just been here, he wouldn't have been dead. But let's read on. Right, that was verse 21. Verse 22, but I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give thee. So she had a statement of faith that he could heal, and she's willing to go even farther with the statement of faith. But I know whatever you ask God, he's going to give you. She knows that, she says. She's got even more faith. 23, Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. And so common saying that they said to comfort people back then because they believed in the resurrection. These were a group of Jews that were Pharisees. They believed in life after death. The Sadducees didn't. They didn't believe in nothing after this life, so they were sad, you see. That old joke. But the Pharisees did. And so Jesus said, your brother will rise again. And naturally Martha's thinking that's what he's talking about in the resurrection. And so Martha said unto him, verse 24, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Well, it wasn't quite what Jesus was talking about. Jesus said unto her, verse 25, this pivotal verse here. Dig into this verse. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. What a statement. This I am statement. This is who Jesus claims to be. You know, many times I'll say to people, do you accept God on his terms? That means, do you accept God as who he says he is and what he says he can do? This is what Jesus says he is. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Verse 26, and whosoever liveth and believeth in me, these people who are still alive, us, you, me, and whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. And then he says, believest thou this? You've made a couple statements of faith. You stated that you knew I could heal. You stated that I could ask God for anything and he'd give it to me. Do you believe this? How about that for a question? The most important question ever asked of anyone, including you and me. Do you believe that? 27, her answer comes. She says unto him, yea, Lord, yes. I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. Statement of faith. You are it. You are the Christ. I believe it. What does that mean? That means Martha's a Christian. Did you ever stop and think about that? We have a recorded thing of a Christian here. She believes in the Christ and that it was Jesus. So Jesus as the Son of God, as the Christ, wasn't that what they were going to stone him all for in chapter 10? And she says, I believe it. So she's risking stoning, I guess. Let's read on here. I'm going to read a little ways before I stop. She believes he's the Christ that's come into the world. Verse 28. And when she had said, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, the Master is come, and he calleth for thee. And why do you suppose they're being secret? Let's focus in a little bit. Remember, they wanted to kill him. He had been fled. They weren't exactly sure how much they should reveal that Jesus was around. So she whispers in her ear, right? Not to clue in all these hired professional mourners. 29. As soon as she had heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. 30. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in the place where Martha had met him. 31. The Jews then, which were with her, with Mary, in the house, and comfort her, paid comforting, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, they followed her, saying, she goeth unto the grave to weep. Let's go with her there. We can play our flutes and wail and carry on there at the gravesite. Verse 32. Then when Martha was come where Jesus was, and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother would not have died. So she had the exact same greeting as Mary. They both knew very well that Jesus could have healed him. And they're probably somewhat perplexed why he wasn't there. But it's not a real criticism. It's really a statement of faith, if you will. Verse 33. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came with her, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled. Okay, so here we go. Here's the place where the King James Bible shines through. Okay, and if you read another version, that's okay, but let me point something out to you. If you have a translation that says deeply moved, and if you're not reading King James, you probably have a translation that says Jesus was deeply moved. Now that could be very misleading, because the word for groan here, the Greek word, involves anger and indignation. Not sympathy or sadness. Angry. Okay? So you could be misled by a different translation that says deeply moved. Now why would Jesus be angry? Why was he angry? Well, let's look at it again. Verse 33. Get our focus knob out. Focus in here on the picture. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, now her weeping was real. She's going to miss her brother, although she has faith that he will rise again. But the Jews also weeping came with her. This mockery, this phony weeping, this professional paid weeping. What kind of a thing is that? Now, we as Jewish people, he's probably thinking, or Pharisees, and we either believe there's a resurrection and a life after death and a reward waiting for us, or we don't. Why are we acting as if this is the end of all things? It just sets wrong with him. He's angry about this whole mockery of this situation. It's one thing to empathize with somebody who's going to miss their loved one. It's another thing to make a big show and a mockery of all this. So Jesus was angry. He groaned. Right? Verse 33. Get the picture there. He groaned. And was troubled, it said. That's the whole weird thing here. Verse 34. And said, where have ye lain him? Let's get to the point. Let's get past all this mockery and nonsense. Where have you laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Well, come this way. And here we have the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. Now, this isn't confusing. Here he does emotionally cry. Right? Well, he was just angry in that verse. Well, he was angry over that nonsense. But now he is grieving. Shortest verse in the English Bible. And here's a portrait. He wept. He wept. Why would Jesus cry? Does he think Lazarus will never, he'll never see him again? Well, no. He knows he's going to raise him from the dead. Does God have a problem with death? No. He has power over death. I often tell people in my line of work as a nurse, death isn't the worst thing that can happen to you. in this life, strangely enough. And they always look at me sometimes perplexed. Usually not if they're Christians. What? It's not. There's many worse things that can happen to you. So why did Jesus weep? Well, it wasn't because Lazarus laid in the tomb. It wasn't because of the mockery that was going on around him. He weeps for the same reason he always weeps, for the sin that came into the world, for the fall of mankind, for the plight that we find ourselves in, subject to this sin and everything, all the problems it causes. He empathizes with us in our pain. We know that's true. We read that in Hebrews. He empathizes in our pain, and most likely it's pain brought on by sin, some way, shape, or form, somewhere down the line, usually. Isaiah calls him a man of constant sorrows, well acquainted with our grief. We can read in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7, that he wept at the Garden of Gethsemane for all the sinners. He wept for us there. And I'm going to read just these lyrics from a hymn from the 1700s. I'm sure most of us don't know this hymn, but the lyrics ring true today. It said, "Did Christ o'er sinners weep? And shall our cheeks be dry? Let floods of penitential grief burst from every eye. The Son of God in tears, angels with wonder see. Be thou astonished, O my soul, he shed those tears for thee. He wept that we might weep. Each sin demands a tear. In heaven alone, no sin is found, and there's no weeping there." Amen. And here he was on earth, and he wept. He wept for the sin. Verse 35, Jesus had wept. Read that 10 times, you read 10 verses of the Bible. You can do that in about 10 seconds. Jesus wept, Jesus wept, Jesus wept. Read all my verses today, Pastor. I'll pray for you. Okay, then said the Jews, "Behold how he loved him." Oh, he's going to miss him. Boy, did they get it wrong. He wasn't going to miss anything. He was about to raise him from the dead. "Behold how he loved him." And some of them said, here we go, "Could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind and have caused this, that even this man should have not died?" Couldn't he have done something? If he's so emotionally distraught over this, you would have thought he would have done something about it. Oh boy, isn't that human nature? How many of us like to do that with other people? Why did they do that? What, are they stupid? You know, we think to ourselves, these Monday morning quarterbacks. Verse 38, "Jesus therefore again groaning in himself." Why do you suppose he's groaning now with anger? He knew what they were just thinking and what they had said. "Cometh to the grave." It was a cave and a stone laid upon it. Jesus said, "Take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh." Been 4 days, remember? "For he hath been dead 4 days. And Jesus said unto her, Said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God?" You know, he said he'll rise again. That's what he was talking about. Verse 41. "Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was lain, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hast heard me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me." Once again, this miracle was for us, the people who are witnessing, and we get to witness now via the word of the Lord. 43, "And when he had thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. And Jesus said unto them, Loose him and let him go." What a thing, huh? Here you come with all blindfolded and been laying in a grave for 4 days. And you hear Jesus call your name. Boy, whew, You ever find yourself laying in a grave, you better hope you hear Jesus call your name. Amen. What a good place to be in. Jesus has the power over death. Amen. We do not. You and I by ourselves, we don't have any power over death. If Lazarus didn't either. If he was laying in that grave and Jesus hadn't come along, he'd still be there. Without Jesus, where are we going to find ourselves? That's all we'll read today. I think we got a nice little picture. A little portrait. And so, if you've accepted God on His terms, what did I say that meant? That He is who He says He is and can do what He says He can do. God says, I am. I am because I am. Nobody made me. Jesus Christ said, I am the resurrection and the life. He's the truth. No one comes to the Father but by Him. If you've accepted God on those terms, and if you've allowed the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your heart and to forgive you of your sins, if He's forgiven you of your sins and made you a new person, if all those things apply to you, that means you're a Christian, He will one day wipe every tear from your eyes. The Bible says that's so. And He's going to know what each one of those tears were for. He will have shed the tear with you. And He will wipe those from your eyes. And so now, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, I'll just say right now to you, you have a sin problem. You have a sin problem. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, you haven't suffered any pain or grief that He's not familiar with. He's familiar with your sin problem. He loves you like no other person can. Nevertheless, He's made you an offer that you've not accepted if you haven't accepted Him. And you have a sin problem, and I pray right now, right where you're at, if you're watching this online, or even if you're here and you don't know the Lord, I pray that you are convicted of sin right now. That the Holy Spirit would come upon you with a conviction of your sin. That you would sit in the place that you're at and you would say, man, I'm in trouble because I've done some stuff that is bad. And I'm going to have to pay a price for that. That's called conviction of sin. And I pray that comes upon you right now. May you come weeping to the weeping Savior, huh? To the picture that we saw here of Jesus who weeps. May you weep now. Because you know what? He'll save you right now, right where you're at. He will save you. The kingdom of God is at hand right now. Salvation is available to you right now. Don't tarry, because tomorrow is promised to no one. In this time of COVID, we know that's so true. We see it all around us. But it's not a joke. It's tomorrow is promised to no one, whether it's COVID or whatever it is. Something can befall you. You don't have time. The kingdom of God is at hand right now. Ask Him into your heart and into your life now. Don't wait. Matter of fact, just bow your heads right where you're at right now and pray like this if you want saved from your sins, if you want an escape, if you want a hope of a future, if you want your life to be worth anything. Pray now. Pray, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner and I weep for those sins that I have committed and I know without You I have nothing. All I have is a grave waiting for me and death. So come now, Lord. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Make me something new. Bring me to life. Fill me with Your Holy Spirit, Lord. I accept You as the Lord and Savior of the world, as the Christ. Be my Savior. Help me to be a child of God. This day, right now, in Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, You are going to have a special Christmas this year. Amen. Like none you've ever had. You've now entered into the family of God. You get to celebrate Christmas in a new way. You really get to enjoy the gift that was given because you've received it now. And that's what this season is about. It's receiving the gift. If you don't receive the gift, it didn't really mean anything to you. So you've received the gift. And if you've done that, reach out to your Christian friends that you've talked about. Maybe you've laughed and joked about them all these years. Oh, they believe in all that nonsense and they spend that time and go to church and it's all a bunch of hooey. Now it's real. Reach out to them. Say, you know what? I got saved. Boy, they're going to be so happy. It's going to be a Christmas present. You won't have to buy them anything for Christmas this year. Just the fact that you came to the Lord Jesus Christ is going to be a gift like no other you could give them. Reach out to them now. Call the church. Do whatever it takes. Don't fall through the cracks, though. Make it real. We're here to help because we love you. Stand, if you would, everyone. I'm going to dismiss us. Bow our heads. Let us pray. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you and give you peace. May He bless you as you go out these doors. May He bless you as you go into the doors wherever you're going and wherever you find yourself. May the Lord make you a blessing to the people you are around while He is blessing you. Lord, I pray every spiritual blessing on these people in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us to share the light of the world here in this season, this time of Christmas. Help us to share the light and the love that you have for mankind to the people we come into contact with. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Be blessed.